paper and the calendar, it says the event starts at 6, but Invest Best says it starts at 6:30, so we might have some people straggling in. Just make them feel welcome. I would like to thank the bookstore for all that they do to support literary art in our community. To these events to sell books. And if you are not already a member of the Friends of the Homer Library and you enjoy programs like these, I encourage you to become a member and to think of us when you fill out your PFD applications and click give. A couple upcoming library dates. March 5th is the deadline to submit a nomination for Celebration of Lifelong Learning. If you know somebody incredible in the community, which I'm sure you do, who have made a commitment to being a lifelong learner and to sharing that passion with others in the community, then I encourage you to submit a nomination. And then our next author reading will be March 12th with Nicole Stellan O'Donnell as part of the Alaska Reads program. She's a poet. And she will be here at home for a couple days doing workshops and an author reading. So, there's a couple people coming in, so go ahead and get comfortable. And with that, I will turn it over to my former music teacher.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much for showing up. Everybody hear me okay? Because I cannot hear very well myself. I have beautiful hearing aids, and that will launch me on my first story. Best stories are told of those I never planned to tell. So I'm on my first national tour with my daughter Jewel, and I have hearing aid problems, and I'm worried, you know, my ears gonna hold out, because too much noise just makes them shut down. And she's worried about her vocal cords. Oh, my vocal cords gonna hold up, or my vocal cords gonna hold up. And so I'm paranoid about my hearing, she's paranoid about her vocal cords. And so all going down the coast of California, I swim every opportunity I get, and I don't wear earplugs, and so I get an ear infection and fly to Texas to our next gig. And my ear is blowing up, 10 o'clock, get a long distance doctor who prescribes something to kill the pain and the infection, and I lose my hearing in my left ear, so I'm down to one ear. Well, that's fine. You're a singer and you are down by one ear. And that ear is only about half good, so I'm about like quarter, 25%. And because to sing on key, you have to hear yourself. You have to hear the guitar to sing on pitch. Well, and I've been having pitchy problems anyway, and that was hard enough to adjust to having sung all your life and suddenly realizing you can't do what's just come natural to you all your life. And more than physically tough to get used to, it's an emotional, it's a bummer, you know? So now I'm down to one ear. So we make it through the night at the concert, and the boys and Jewel come up to me later and say, "Dad, you were dead on tonight. I mean, your pitch was perfect." And I said, "Okay, might be something to be said for mono hearing." So anyway, the hearing finally came back. But I'd be on stage, and my Nikos would be here, and Otsley would be here, and we were kind of doing songwriting style, trading songs, and I really couldn't hear what Nikos or Otsley were saying because of the house sound, and I would just sit there and go, "Oh, did you ask me something?" You know, do the old man kind of nod, then you go, "Huh? What was that for me?" So, had a lot of fun with hearing. Sometimes you just have to trust that it's going to be okay. Well, library. I've done a few book readings already in the lower 48. This is my first one in Alaska, and first one in the library. Now, libraries and I go way back. I think I got in more trouble in libraries than I got in trouble anywhere else. I didn't put that in my book, but Homer High School, junior high, wherever there were libraries, I was always that guy that figured it was a place to mess around, goof off, and get kicked out of. So this morning I came to set up my sound system and I did a little Facebook video and I said, shh, I gotta be real quiet. I can't get kicked out of here because I got a gig here tonight. I had the privilege of being able to narrate my book, and that was quite an experience. I tell anybody who is willing to listen, if you want to change, if you want to look at yourself, if you want to evolve as a human, become more enlightened, more mindful, whatever you want to do, you ought to try writing about your life. And then let somebody get in there and try to edit it. Look through your life all over again and tell you what you did right and what you did wrong and what you did too much and too little of, you know. Bad enough writing about your whole life, and now someone else is down there stirring it around with a big stick. Okay, get that done. Then you get to read it. This should be a breeze. Boy, was that an experience to hear your own voice through the headphones as you're reading what you wrote. I got pretty emotional sometimes, and the audio engineer, the producer, said, I love the emotion you're putting into it, Kilcher, but when you're blubbering, nobody can understand you. You're going to have to read that over again. Well, no matter how old we are, we can always look back at things we did, and we can regret things we did. We can wish we could still do them. But regardless, when we look back, we process. And we either say, yep, glad I did that, or whoa, glad I didn't do that again. But it's always looking back and figuring out some way to process it. I just want to stay on the safe trail. Those familiar places that I already know. Well, I've been lost in the frozen forests. That was someone else long ago. I just want to sit here by my wood stove. In my cozy cabin, sheltered from the wind and snow. Blizzards in the high peaks of the mountains. That was someone else long ago. But that don't mean there ain't times that I reminisce. That don't mean there ain't things that sometimes I still miss. When I hear your man calling from deep down in my soul, well, I just smile and I help him pack his bedroll. Then I wish him well and I let him go. I just want to ride on my old pony. I trained him gentle, and we're both moving slow. Bronc busting days are behind me now. That was someone else long ago. But I'll always be trailblazing when I'm walking through a wild and rugged land. Going deep within, places I've not been. My heart is now the compass in my hand. But that don't mean there ain't times that I sit and reminisce. That don't mean there ain't things that sometimes I still miss. When I hear
wish him well and I let him go. That was someone else long ago. That was someone else long ago.
When my daughter heard that song, she said, "Dad, it kind of makes it sound like you gave up. Makes you sound like you're old." I said, "Well." So I thought about it, and so I added that bridge. I'll always be trailblazing, but I'm walking in a rough and rugged land. Sometimes the internal landscape you pioneer and explore is infinitely rougher than that which we can see and more easily navigate. This book all started, and then it just kind of went from there. I'm amazed that it ended up in a book. I'm amazed I got a book deal. I just wrote a bunch of stuff. I didn't even know how well it would hang together. And I guess how well it sells, and time will tell whether anybody else thinks it hangs together as a book. If not, it's just a bunch of little stories. When my mom and dad divorced, the judge said it was the worst divorce he'd ever heard of. Such a loving couple, such a high-profile family. Yul Kilcher helped write the Constitution of the state of Alaska, was a state senator, my mom, a writer, family, Von Trapper, little singing family, idyllic homestead family. We had governors, we had state congressmen, senators at our house, around our humble homestead table. How could this idyllic homestead family end up in a divorce? Well, the judge, nor the public, nor people in Homer knew what happened within those walls. And a lot of families are that way. You only see what you're allowed to see. So when my mom left, it was pretty bitter. And only she and us kids knew why she left. She left without a dime. She left without an acre of land for the 30 years she was there. And swore she'd never come back. Pioneer determination. With her Swiss accent, "I will never set place on that homestead again." Well, as the years went by, she did sneak out to the homestead once. I took her. She took a little peek and then went back to town. And then the very last time she came up before she passed away, we had a family reunion. And Mom and Dad in the same house. All eight of us kids were there, a lot of grandchildren. It was a charged atmosphere. First time Mom and Dad in the same room. Now my dad came looking just a little bit like Tom Sawyer trying to impress Becky Thatcher. He had on a woven coat that she had woven for him. She'd, on the loom, made whatever you do on the loom, make fabric, then she sewed a coat, a little cap, matching tweed. And so he came wearing that. And the night before she left Alaska, we had another family get together at my sister Faye's house. My mother felt all right about having my father there, so we invited him. This gathering would be close family only, much more intimate than the outdoor potluck we'd had at the homestead. There was tension and apprehension in the air, yet also a sense of calm excitement. My dad hung out mostly in the living room with the teenagers in front of the TV he always preached against. My mother stayed at the dining room table. People were eating everywhere, and the house was filled with the noise of four generations. Suddenly, as if on cue, the noise subsided and the focus shifted. You know, I'm gonna take a break. It's amazing. The human body is just an amazing thing where we store stuff. We can stick it away. We can work through it and let it go. And then we go back to that little place, that little scene, close our eyes, and you know, takes us right back there. That's what PTSD is about now. Getting choked up about that scene, that's okay. But that's the same thing with PTSD. You know, you go, you get that trigger and put you right back there. We all watched and listened with one eye and one ear only. trying not to be too obvious, with bodies half turned away, not to invade this private moment. My father, now 83, had come into the dining room unnoticed and was standing beside my mother's chair. He was leaning down toward her to better hear. He refused to wear hearing aids. He was wearing a hand-woven tweed jacket and matching cap, worn and old, but well-kept. He had a kindly look on his face, eager, yet not invasive, as he sometimes tended to be. His desperation was replaced by a sort of genuineness and peaceful resignation, yet still seeking some reconciliation. "I brought you some potatoes," he shouted down to her, much too loudly. "See here, some white, some red, some banana potatoes, remember? Those are from the special seed we have been hill selecting since Palmer." He looked so eager, so vulnerable. Her gnarled hands, she had rheumatoid arthritis. Her gnarled hands reached up haltingly to receive the gift. Her face and eyes smiled as she caressed the potatoes and admiringly placed them on the table before her. "Thank you," she said while looking down at the potatoes, and then again, "thank you," this time with more feeling, looking up at him. There was something different about the way she was looking at him, a pregnant look. We all felt the weight of it. "I see you are wearing that coat and cap I wove for you in Switzerland." That had been in 57, almost 40 years before. "That's why I wore it. I was hoping you would notice," still loudly, with a proud, almost embarrassed grin. I wondered how he kept track of it all those years. What trouble and how many boxes he'd gone through to dig it out for tonight. And if you knew my dad and you knew the homestead, there just wasn't that much place to put stuff. Somewhere he had it in a box all these years. We all noticed, we all felt the warmth of her hand-woven coat on his back. We all tasted the sweet taste of his homegrown potatoes in her hands, and to seven adult children, also products of their weaving and cultivating, it made a small but important difference. And for just a brief moment, the loom was once again humming, weaving freshly spun yarn, and the rich, dark, virgin soil was being cultivated and planted. Two young immigrants in love were seeing the reflection of their unborn children as they gazed into each other's eyes. Self-consciously, we relaxed our breathing and started moving again. We cleared our throats, snuffled our noses, and wiped our eyes. We turned our backs and moved slowly out of respect for these two old veterans of ancient and half-forgotten battles who, with near-deaf ears and gnarled hands, were slowly beginning to raise that flag of truce. As I can take you there. That's what a songwriter or a writer or a poet tries to do with words. But to be there for that scene, having experienced everything prior to that scene, knowing why she'd refused to come back to Alaska, knowing why she'd refused to come back to the homestead, having been in that small cabin, having seen, having heard, that was one of those moments. And it gave me something. They gave me a gift. An example of getting over it, forgiving, moving on. And I'm a firm believer, no matter how old we are, when we have children, we're always parents. And I'm still doing things that my kids will tell me, "Hey, thanks for that." Thank you. think I can even try to understand how it was back then. Strange land with no friends, only one place to begin. So my mom and my daddy, they dug in. Hand tools and a two-horse team, fresh eggs and whipping cream, picking mushrooms and wild greens, rich soil, fertile greens. Alaskan summers long, young backs were growing strong. Even when things went wrong, there always was time for a song. Before every meal, instead of bowing our heads, we held hands in a family circle. We sang our prayers instead. Sometimes when I was young and angry, didn't always feel like singing along. That's when my mama said, and my daddy said, son, take your time, you'll find your song. My children, take time to find your song. My children, take time to find your song. It was a jungle war on a foreign shore, and I was longing for the free life I had before. Now tell me, was it right or wrong to kill those Viet Cong? Thank God I had my guitar on, and I always took time to find my song. Got married, had children too, did all those things I swore I'd never do. I hate to think what I put them through. I was a single dad without a clue. They're all strong today. Grown up, some moved away. They all write and play. They took time to find their songs in their own way. Sometimes in the middle of a long, hard day, not a word was said. We'd all stop what we were doing. We sang our work instead. Sometimes when I was young and angry, didn't always feel like singing along. That's when my mama said, and my daddy said, son, take your time, you'll find your song. Oh, my children, take time to find your song. My children, take time to find your song. It was a hard life. Man, the older that I am, the more I understand. My mom and my daddy had a plan. Before every meal, instead of bowing our heads, we held hands in a family circle, sang our prayers instead. Sometimes I was young and angry, didn't always feel like singing along. When my mom said, and my shut up, boy, and eat that sauerkraut and moose roast, and maybe when you get all the chores done, we'll take a little time and find your song. My children, take time to find your song. I was doing a show up at the Wildberry Theater in Anchorage. And the very last night, I invited all my siblings. My sister from Germany couldn't make it, but she sent her husband. So there was eight of us on stage singing some of the songs of her childhood. French, Swiss, Swedish, English, whatever. What a wonderful part of our childhood to be taught foreign languages through song. So the news reporter was there from Channel 2, and after the audience all left, he stayed and interviewed us, and one of my siblings, I can't remember which one, said, hey, aunt, so that song you sing, you know, take time to find your song, are you singing about our childhood? Are you singing about the mom and dad I remember? Did I miss the time your dad said, son, take your time? I realize you're a rebellious teenager right now, you know, and you're opposing me as teenagers should, but just take your time, you'll find yourself. They had the nerve to question my song. And here's what I said, and here's what I've been saying ever since. You know what? And this, you can bottle it, you can sell it if you want, but it is the key to happiness. I love that movie City Slicker where he goes, the key, what does he keep saying? The secret to life, that old guy. Now that song might only be 2% true. It might only be 1% true, but you know what? It did happen, I think. I'm pretty sure. At least 1 or 2% of the time, my dad was understanding. And you know what? The more I tell myself that and believe it and live and hang out in that happy moment, it spreads to 5, 10%. And any more now, it's all good. I think about my dad, it's great. He was a great dad, I was a great son. He did great, I did great. I had beautiful dreams about him. He talks to me more now in my dreams, I talk to more him more. Incredible. And those dreams I have about my dad are just as real as that reality was. So the key to happiness, think of those happy moments, and just stay there. Some people might call it denial, whatever. But you know what? You don't become happier by hanging out in the sad places. So that is my philosophy of life. Find that good percentage and stretch it out. I'm not going to read you the whole Veterans Day chapter. It's a pretty good chapter about going to Vietnam, being there, coming back. But I'm going to read you just a little bit about it. What the hell is Veterans Day all about? How is it different from Memorial Day? Which World War are we talking about here? I'm a Vietnam vet and I'm not sure. One is in the fall, the other is in the spring. They have something to do with World War I and World War II, and I think one or the other is sort of like Christmas. Whatever we're commemorating really happened on a different date. Sometimes I remember to say Happy Veterans Day to a few vet friends, and sometimes one or two say to me. Every year the greetings get fewer, both coming and going. My kids are probably the best to remember. Being honored by anyone feels good. Having one of your kids take the time to remember, to reflect on something their parents did, and then actually take the time to say thanks, well, that's pretty damn special. For some reason, my son Otsley has been the most consistent ever since he was a teenager. What makes it even more memorable is that he says more than just Happy Veterans Day. He usually makes a statement, only a few words, but he's able to convey his view of war in general, and that one in specific, and still thank and honor me. Of course, much of the cause of my amazement is the fact that he was mute in his early teen years. If he communicated with me at all back then, it was in nods of the head and grunts, or monosyllabic complaints. Other less endearing bodily gestures, such as subtle eye rolling, were common also. And you know, he'd be on the phone with his friends, and I'd listen to the conversation, but yo, dude, half our conversation just saying the word dude, and somehow he'd hang up and say, yeah, hello, John, and we're going to meet down at the beach, and we're going to go up to gyms, you know. But I give Otsley a hard time all the time. I don't know how he made it through those years without hardly talking. But last year's phone message from him went like this. Went much like this year's. Happy Veterans Day, Dad. Thanks for what you did over there. I suppose thanking you might mean I agree with the war, which I don't, so maybe thank you is not the right word. Maybe it should be thanks for coming home, for enduring, not letting it take you down. So that's the message I get from my son, Otsley. This year, he said, thanks for your brave years of war. I couldn't imagine the things you endured. You will always be my Zen hero. Jane says thanks, too. Well, I have no clue what a Zen hero is. probably something from his artist-songwriter's mind. So in my artist's mind, I interpreted it thusly: calm, accepting, centered, enduring, spiritual, trying to see everything as an opportunity for growth, for learning, for seeing the connectedness of all things. Now don't get me wrong, that's not me. That's not how I would describe myself. But rather, the picture that comes to mind for the term Zen hero. Of course, the word hero conjures up countless more images and definitions, and believe me, that ain't me neither. The point here is that he chose those two words to describe me at that moment in time. Who am I to dispute it, question it, or intellectualize it? So I basked in the warm glow of the energy of those words. I let them soak in, do their job, wash, cleanse, heal, blow the dust off important memories, and bury others in a deep layer of love and forgiveness. It just so happens that this same son, Ants Lee, knowing was a great reader of self-help books, and maybe thinking I needed yet another one, or one of a different ilk, gave me a book on a Japanese approach to healing, self-growth, and awareness. It was called Even in Summer, the Ice Doesn't Melt. The book was as different as its title. The thing I remember about the book was a concept diametrically opposed to all I'd learned in my psychology and social work training. I'd strived hard in my life up to that point to understand my feelings. I tried hard to focus on who I was, not what I did. On being more of a human being instead of a human doing. This very different book taught that to be different, to feel different, one needed to do different. If you want to be a kind person, feel kind, then get off your butt and do a bunch of kind deeds long enough until you are a kind person. Simple. This was an especially bitter pill to swallow because my dear old, very non-Zen-like daddy used to say the same thing. You go out to the homestead, let's do something. And I think, why do you always have to be doing stuff? Can't we just, you know, sit and enjoy each other's company? Well, maybe my dad was onto something. Perhaps he had long before learned that it was in the doing that he felt the most at peace. Nonetheless, I incorporated that new and important belief of doing what you want to be into my ongoing search for meaning and happiness, and it made a difference. A part of that difference was that this particular son, who lived with me the longest as a single dad and saw more of my very worst un-Zen-like behavior, was drawn to the Zen book and gave it to me. This same son also said I was his Zen hero. Must be something wrong with that boy. I'm not going to read all the bad parts here because you guys would all be walking out. I tell people, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, the 10 being, you know, my dad killing me, I only went to about a 5. And the same with my kids. You know, I kept it in the PG realm. But this is the same boy that we were going home late one night. He was the last one in the nest, stuck with old dad for better or for worse. And we'd been to a Peter Pan movie, and I was kind of emotional watching this Peter Pan thing there with my son, and I said something very tender and emotional to him, and he rolled his eyes and made some really angry teenage remark that hurt me. And so walking home in the snow, me in snowshoes, him in skis, I brought that up and he smarted off to me and I backhanded him and we went down in the snow and he was down and I was on top of him, thumping him in the chest, and I can't even remember what I was telling him, but I was angry because he'd hurt my feelings because he was rude to me when I was trying to make a nice fatherly loving comment to him at that very tender emotional Peter Pan movie, and I was furious. And I thumped and thumped on him, and he was trying to get away from me, and I was on top of him. Going back to the cabin, he's up in his room crying. Listen to Bob Dylan. Children, you aren't your parents. One of those Bob Dylan, you know, poor me. And so I went to sleep, listening to my son up there crying. This is the boy I'm talking about. Thanks for your brave years of war. I couldn't imagine the things you endured. You will always be my Zen hero. Whew. That's what I'm talking about. That's a whole lot of good stuff wrapped up in a very short message. For me, it goes to show you how little it takes to make somebody's day, how deeply mere words can take us to those places needing visited. None of us who take the time to honor someone have any idea exactly what it leaves that person feeling or how far it may take them. His words led me down a trail of long ago that started when I got drafted. So the rest of that book, the rest of that chapter has to do with Otsley telling me that Veterans Day that I was his Zen hero. Now I could have laughed at it, scoffed at it. That ain't me. Son, you've been drinking, been smoking. That's not me you're talking about. But I let it soak in, and it allowed me to do some healing and to wander down some trails that needed walked on. It takes a little. You never know the cruel thing you say, what it'll do to somebody. You never know the thoughtful thing, what it'll do. I did a house concert down in Seattle, and little did I know that one of the gentlemen, I didn't know he was a Vietnam vet. He was same age as me, been over there the same time as me, had also been a cook. And little did I know that singing this song that I'm going to sing to you now would take him, this was a couple years ago, so he was 68 at the time, and it started him for the first time. Came home at 22, 68, you do the math. Never dealt with anything. This song triggered in him something, and he decided to start dealing with this stuff. His nephews, his nieces, his brothers say, can't believe it. Always had a dream of coming to Alaska. He came up here. Froggy lived out in the woods in a cabin, been his dream for a year. Came to Alaska, lived in a cabin. We had a lot of good times together. Thank goodness that we live in a day and age where talking about things is easier. We all have more tools, self-help books, videos, seminars, mental health, whatever, that, you know, my parents' generation didn't have. And there's a lot of talk. It's things are being talked about more, being discussed. And the whole topic of healing, you talk to 10 specialists, they'll probably all tell you 10 different things. This song called PTSD just talks very simply about, you want to feel better? Just go back, go back, go back until you find yourself at whatever age was happy. 8, 10, 12, 6. Okay. So you meet that happy little guy and you say, I want to hang out with you. And you hang out with that happy little guy long enough and you can become that little happy guy again. I just made that up. But I've read a lot about PTSD and I've been to a lot of PTSD workshops. And I think you could take all the PTSD books and boil it about down to that. You know, it's not about what's going on right now. It's not about what triggered you. That's just all reaction. You once were undamaged, you know, and you can go back there. So when I came back from Vietnam, when I've been in my life trying to find calm, peaceful places, it's not hard. I go to the head of the bay. I've been going up there since I was a teenager. And it's a place I go physically, it's a place I go in my mind. No matter where I am, you can close your eyes and visualize. PTSD, you'll tell me, what have you done to me? You've been wrecking my heart, you've been scrambling my brain. Can't put my fingers on it, but I know I'm not the same as that long ago young cowboy that riding on the range. Could have been the mom and dad I had. Sometimes their very best still was pretty bad. Could have been that year in Vietnam, my soul was rearranged.
came back, was called a killer. He said I was deranged, so I went looking for that young cowboy. Dad riding on the range. I still can hear the hoofbeats running, see the blowing mane, feel the wind blowing in my hair, strong hands holding the reins. He's still out there somewhere, I know he hasn't changed. Gonna find that young cowboy, cat riding on the range. World Wars, Afghanistan's, Vietnam's, and Iraq's. Send us your young and strong, not sure what you'll get back. Peaceful homes are shattered, filled with fear and pain. Children hiding from the thunder, running from the rain. They're all looking for that young cowboy out riding on the range. I still can hear the hoofbeats running, see the flowing mane, feel the wind blowing in my hair, my young strong hands holding the reins. Well, he's still out there somewhere, I know he hasn't changed. Gonna find that young cowboy, out riding on the range. Gonna find that young cowboy, out riding on the range. Riding on the range, oh, he's still out there. Riding on the range, I can see him. Riding on the range, we're getting closer now. Riding on the range, side by side now. Riding on the range, how you doing there, young feller? How's it been? Riding on the range, pretty good. How you doing, old man? Been here and there. Doing okay, I guess. So what have you been doing up here? Yeah, just happy, hanging out. Riding the range, wind in my hair. You want to hang out with me, old man? That's why I'm here, boy. I'll take you over across the river. Want me to show you the way? I know where to avoid the quicksand. I know how to avoid the deep places. Okay, son, lead the way. Riding on the range, riding on the range, riding on the range. That's what it's all about. Talked to someone just the other day who'd been to a healing workshop talking about the latest experts in PTSD research. Talk about all the things that are damaged during your trauma, whether a lifetime of it or a year of it, whatever, and how you got to go back and re-father yourself and re-mother yourself. And I go, oh yeah, I think that's what I'm doing when I'm up there riding the range with my imaginary younger self. I think I'm doing some re-fathering. How are we doing on time? What time's it getting? Quarter to seven. Beautiful. Time races. Well, let's see. I'm gonna read a little bit about out of the last chapter. I saved the best for last. This is called Case's Town. I got a grandson named Case. His middle name is Towns. Case Towns and Murray. So when he came to visit me, I made a little town, put up a sign called Case's Town, made some roads, there's a pond, built him a little cabin. I thought, what impression can I make on him first time to Alaska? What can I do? So I just pretended I was five, and I thought I'll just do those things I enjoyed doing when I was 5 years old. But the big worry I had, and it's even goes beyond a worry, because I have always been very challenged in the patience department.
My dad did a real good job of passing that down to me. And all my life I've said if there's one thing I could change about myself, it'd be to be more patient and more loving. Two pretty big things. Love and patience. I've never had a good grasp on those two concepts. I understand the words well enough, but to get right down to it, it might be more accurate to say I've never been a calm and patient person. And I don't know that I've ever felt deep, pure love for someone and felt it in return. So, one of my ex-wives once asked me in exasperation how it was that I could be so sensitive to impatience in others and yet be such an impatient person myself. Apparently, she'd never met anybody or experienced herself the very sad truth that often we do the very things we hate to see in others. In one moment, I could be the quivering child in fear of impatience, and the next, I could be a raging, out-of-control, impatient adult. So, having experienced impatience, having seen what it did to me, having seen what it did to my kids and close relationships, of course, it wasn't a matter of wondering if I would be able to be a loving, patient opa to Case. It was just a matter of how many days would I make it before I blew it, before I screamed at him, yelled at him, was impatient, did something very non-loving, and, you know, he'd be out of there. So I kind of saw this like the last train out of Dodge. I'd had a lot of kids. I'd had a few wives. I'd had a few grandkids. I took Case on as, this is it, man. Time to cowboy up here. So far, so good. I show him around his little town. I'm making big points. I'm feeling good, but I haven't had any really challenges yet. So I take him down to a patch of alders, because when I was a kid, I used to love to play in the alders. All of us kids had little imaginary houses. So finally, it was time to make those magical alder houses. I had already built a trail into the center of a dense alder thicket and cleared a space. I'd set up a short section of a log, standing on end with a piece of gray board on top, serving as a table. I told him it was time to go and have an early birthday party in his special house. His eyes lit up like a dream come true. This old school opa had made the grade. I told him I had to go ahead to make sure everything was ready. I wanted to be sure I could see his face as he entered our fantasy realm, the realm of my own childhood. The walls, the roof, and the door were all made of flexible alders and branches I'd woven together. Light came in through the center, and I had my little guitar by the table, which was set with cupcakes and ice cream. All was prepared. And I performed on many stages in my life. I've seen enthralled audiences as they breathlessly watched and listened to my daughter and I yodel in harmony. I used to teach elementary music. I know what little excited, expectant faces look like. But Case's face, as he came around that last alder and in the branch door with his mom, his huge eyes and his open mouth, took me right back. This was it. We'd made it. We were in the magic zone. We had a party there, each of us sitting on a round of wood around our gray wood table. And beneath the green roof leaves, we ended the day with a song about a hermit thrush who lived in the alders that my older sister Mossy wrote when she was 13. Playing in her own alder house in the canyon, she taught it to me. I taught it to my daughter, and she taught it to Case. Three generations still in the alders, still singing about that hermit thrush. And on this tour I went on with Jewel across the whole country, many nights, little six-year-old Case joined his mom on stage and sang, down in the canyon, deep in the alders, where the hermit thrushes sing. His little voice and mom, she'd sing quieter and quieter and quieter back away from the mic. And pretty soon, little Case singing to big audiences that song. It was getting late. They traveled far in the day and they were tired. When Jewel asked Case if he wanted to stay with Opa, I was sure he'd have had his fill of this unfamiliar place and these grandparents he didn't know well. But he said yes, as though it were the most natural thing in the world. And we all slept well that night. I went to sleep picturing the old cowboy smiling. I talk a lot in this book about kind of my inner guide. I just make him out to be an old cowboy. When I don't know what to do, I ask him what to do, and usually he steers me pretty much in the right direction. When I woke up, he was standing beside my bed. "Opa, can we go down to my alder house?" I'm one of those grouchy wakers, at least until I've had several cups of coffee, but didn't have time for the usual morning funk to settle down on me. Before I knew it, I had my guitar in one hand and my grandson in the other, and we headed back down to the magic zone. We talked, we sang, and then out of the corner of my eye, I saw a fluttering bird. It had landed just a few feet above our heads in an alder branch. Now, me being a storyteller and a BSer, and sometimes in my earlier days a liar, you may be sitting there wondering if I'm making this up. But, you know, get on the phone, call my grandson. It happened. Its rust-colored back and speckled breast turned me right off. It was a hermit thrush. I pointed without a word, and he whispered, "Is that a hermit thrush?" "Yes." I could hardly believe it. "He must have heard us. That's why he came." There was only one way to respond to that. Yep, that's why he came. I almost blew it, though, down in Las Vegas last week. I switched from coffee to black tea. It's still an addiction, but I'm kind of working my way. Next stop is going to be green tea, and after that, just herb tea. But right now, I'm on the black tea train, and I take my little addiction still very seriously. First black cup of tea of the day, and I'm sitting there, and wanting my alone time. Well, Case wants to come out there and be with me. Okay, breathe deep. What's more important, having my alone time with my cup of black tea and doing my little morning songwriting, or hanging out with my grandson? Okay, get a grip. Sure, grandson, come on out. He helped me write songs. He loves to whistle. He whistles while I'm singing. When he went in the door, he's got to drag the curtain in with him. When he comes out, he drags the curtain out with him. Well, one time when he drug it going in, it came back, knocked my sacred black tea that I'd hardly gotten a sip out of yet on the floor. And I went, bit my tongue before I could say anything. I say, thank you very much. But that's the closest I've come to getting impatient. But there was another time when he was up here with me. We gotten in the car, and it's not just simple anymore. You just get off and get in the car and go. When you have a grandson, a five-year-old, those of you who have little kids, you know, it's this and it's that, then it's that. We get all bucked, and he said, "Opa, could you go get Fluff Fluff, little bunny rabbit?" I said, "Sure, grandson." I get out of the car, unbuckle, walk 10 steps to the stairs, 5 steps up the steps, 10 steps in, a long journey, bring him Fluff Fluff. Buckle back in, he goes, "Opa, could you go get Pink Froggy?" He flings his frog against the window, it sticks. Wherever he flings it, it sticks. Okay, so I go in and I finally, after searching through the whole house, find Pink Froggy. I'm thinking, "You can do this, Opa. Ain't nothing else you gotta do here." Yet buckled up, he says, "Opa, I forgot Sippy Cup." Well, we need Sippy Cup. So I go back in, and then I can just, and I tune in. Took me 7 years to learn that little concept. Tune in, what's going on? Oh, I'm vibrating. If you ask me to go get one more thing, I might throw Pink Froggy and Fluff Up and Sippy Cup right through the window. But we made it. We made it. My newest song. To sing a song that you haven't sung before, usually you want to cheat and read it. But at some point, you got to make that transition to memory. And so this is Stumble Fumble Memory Night. Well, I had a father. He used to love to blame. He passed it on down to me. And I passed on my share of shame. Driven by demons, he used to scream and shout. It was the only way he knew to chase those devils out. Oh, my children, that's what it was all about. Never made a conscious choice to survive. He had to
run away from the mercenary's voice. When the firing squad said, ready, aim, and the bloodhound began to bay. Well, he trampled over everything and everything that he could try to get into his way. Oh, my children, you better get out of the way. Oh, my children, sometimes you didn't get out of the way. There's different memories, as there always will be. But on this one thing, we all can agree. That we had it hard, we had it rough. But we got all there was, we all got enough. Of the tools it takes to sift and sort, till only good remains. Pure pioneer blood pumping through our veins. We got pure pioneer blood pumping through our veins.
There's another verse. We'll come floating in here in a minute.
Different points of view, as always there will be. But on this one thing, we can agree. We all had it hard sometimes, we had it rough. We got all there was, we all got enough. Of the tools it takes to sift and sort, till only good remains. We all got pure pioneer blood pumping in our veins. Pure pioneer blood pumping in our veins. Hard working, no shirking, guaranteed one thing's for certain. We all got pure pioneer blood pumping through our veins. Don't quit, dig right in. Don't want to sing, gotta learn how to swim. We got pure pioneer blood pumping through our veins.
I remember my mom on the homestead. She'd start out with about 2 cups of flour with lumps and clumps in it. Then she'd sift it through that little hand squeezer flour sifter. She'd end up with about 4, 5, 6 cups of really fine flour, just sifting and sorting. Then she'd add a little bit of homegrown egg, a little bit of butter, some homemade milk, a little bit of sugar. Hop it in the oven, come right out. Oh, those homestead kids, we'd be dancing around, happy, and we'd give a shout, seeing what mama's fine sift of powder made for us. Oh, my children, pioneer blood pumping in your veins. Keep sorting and sifting till all that good fine is all that remains. Well, I had a father. He did the best he could. And after spending a lifetime of sorting and sifting, with all that's left now, is a big fine pile of good. Thank you. So, one key of life I gave you earlier, and I can't remember what that was now. I hope somebody recorded it. But this is the other key of life, you know. That's our job. You get given a bunch of stuff, either by your parents, your family, or life. And then it's your job to sort and sift through it and choose what you want to keep. and what you want to give back, and keep sorting and sifting, and until you find the good stuff, and then just hang out right there. Thank you. It's been a pleasure.